Hi, I'm Liu Ying with Xinhua News Agency, wondering how we can tell a story without voicing a word. At the recently opened annex in Tibet Museum, ancient treasures tell tales of the region in silence. So I'm now in the Tibet Museum, having myself dressed up in Tibetan style, and I'm ready to have a good conversation with the ancient treasures. So we're now heading to the exhibition on Tibetan folk culture, which named People Closest to the Sun. It gives a glimpse into the daily life of the Tibetan. And today, we're glad to have Gatso, who will be introducing some of the display of the exhibition. Now let's go and find him.
So
the exhibition covers an area of 2,700 square meters. And it displayed over 700 pieces of exhibits.
我们马上要看到这边呢，就是我们要讲到的这个三八袋，也就是仓库。
So this one we can see over there is its name is Tangu in Tibetan.
What's这个是用来做什么的呢？这个呢叫做这个汤固，也是藏语的音译。那么一般被译指为皮口袋，那么是用来揉捏糌粑所使用的物品。一般在下乡生活当中的时候，人们会携带。那么也是在这里面揉捏的糌粑呢，有这个用量非常大且卫生的一个特点。
So this one. Tangu is the leather bag, and which is usually made of the sheepskin to make traditional Tibetan food, zamba. It can provide food for several people.
那么我们平时也会在木碗之中揉捏糌粑。
So in the daily life, they will also use a wooden bowl to make zamba, the traditional Tibetan food as well.
对，我们在这边也可以看到有非常多的瓷碗。那么瓷碗呢，在过去由于这个运输交通等方面运送到了西藏，那么也是以它的这个易清洗的特点和非常丰富的色彩，深受人们的喜爱。那么在过去呢，是由达官贵人所使用。那么在现在，由于这个交通也非常的方便，也成为了咱们日常生活当中最为常见的一个所使用的一个碗。
We can see over there the porcelain bowl was also used in the past, but with the poor circumstances of transportation, it was often used in the noble families. It gets much easier to transport those porcelains to Tibet, so it now became a popular daily necessaries in Tibetans' families now.
那么我们在这边也可以看到有非常多具有特色的这些服饰文化。那么我们也可以看到有包含农区的这些服饰，还有我们林区和牧区的服饰都是有相应的在这边有所体现，也是在我们非物质文化遗产当中也是具有一定性代表的，都在此有所展出。那么包含了也是我们之间各个地区居住的人口较少民族的服饰呢，也是在此有所呈现的。
We can see the clothes shown here belongs to different regions, different parts of Tibet, and some of them are also the intangible cultural heritage of Tibet now.
那么我们在前面马上我们就要看到的是我们在拉萨地区，也就是我们所说农区最具有代表性的这个石器的平顶屋。
So here we can see this is the most commonly seen buildings in Lhasa is the flat it's a flat top building.
我们可以看到这个建筑外侧呢，都是使用了较易取材的牛粪砖来进行搭建。那么也可以看到，我们在这个墙上呢，也是有各式各样的这样的手抓纹。在下雨天的时候，雨季较为充沛的时候，手抓纹它可以防止这个雨堆积在这个我们的墙壁表面，甚至墙壁会滑下来。
So the wall was made from the brisk of called dung, which is easy to find in Tibet, And we can see the patterns over the wall. It was originally handmade during the rain season. The water won't be kept on the wall, but will get down from the wall, so it won't make the wall too wet.
那么我们在这边除了有农区的房屋呢，我们也可以看到有非常多具有特色的林区的房屋，斜顶式、橄榄式的这种木屋，还有我们这种牧区的帐篷呢，都是非常具有这些特色的这些房屋，都在此为大家有一个很直观的一个呈现。
So apart from the buildings we can see in Lhasa, there are also tents and other styles of buildings in different parts of Tibet. Actually, we can see from all those buildings the wisdom of Tibetan people. Apart from those huge constructions, we can also have a look about the techniques of the artisans in Tibet on some small delicacies. 就是我们也可以在一些小的手工艺品上看到他们的这些精湛的制作。
是的，是的。那我们整体的这个展览部分呢，手工艺品它也是占据着一个主要的一个地位。那么我们在这个二楼的这个通识展里面，也有专门的一个展区，是展出我们相关的一些手工艺品。那么我们，
There are lots of pieces of artifacts shown in this exhibition. It shows the delicate skills of the Tibetan people. And upstairs, there are also several ancient artifacts displayed there. Probably we can find out later. 那我们现在是在往哪边去？
我们现在正式要前往我们手工业技艺的这个部分。那么在我们现在身处的这个地方呢，是我们农业生产和牧业生产的一个过渡的一个区域。我们也可以看到有非常多农业和牧业的这些相关的物品在这里。在这边马上到前面的话，我们就可以看到这个专门制作陶器的这个整个的发展的历史。我们可以看到这边最为重要的这个展品呢，就是我们所说的这个陶制海螺。此件陶制海螺呢，是日喀则谢通门县的一位老人，非遗物种文化遗产传承人制作并捐赠给我们博物馆的。由于它这个陶制海螺成型呢是非常的复杂的，所以制作起来烧制的工艺呢也是极其困难的，所以是非常考验这个手艺人的这个手艺的。
So we can see here is the pottery conch. It was sent to the Tibet Museum from an inheritor in Xinhua, because it's difficult skills to make the conch. So this one is really precious.
我们也可以看到在这边展牌之上呢，我们可以看到陶器的发展呢，最早可以追溯到4000年前，也就是昌都卡若遗址出土的双体陶罐呢，就将我们的这个历史追溯到了4000年前，在这个我们二楼的《雪域长歌》历史文化展当中也有所体现。
We can see over there is the picture of the development of the pottery in timeline, and we can see at the last one, which dates back to 4,000 years before, is the double-body pottery jar. Although we can only see pictures here, but we have the original pieces on the second floor in the exhibition on history. 那我们接下来就去二楼去看一下。
我们接下来就要上到我们的二楼去参观。
好，那感谢您对我们今天的一个讲解。
没事。
好，谢谢。So, thanks a lot for Gatso's introduction. We're now heading up to upstairs to find out more about the history of Tibet. Tibetan folk customs is an important part of the traditional Chinese culture. Its development has witnessed the journey of all Chinese ethnic groups in writing a long history and creating a splendid cultural heritage. Apart from this exhibition, another one on Tibetan history also has a lot of stories to tell. Let's go and check out.So here we're at the entrance of the exhibition on Tibetan history and culture. Today we are very honored to have Professor He Xiaodong, who is the curator of the exhibition, and he will share some of his insights with us. He 教授您好。
你好。
你好，你好。
你好。
能不能请您给我们介绍一下我们这个历史展的一个基本的一个情况？
好的。
我们可以边走边说。
好好好。这个是西藏通史陈列《雪域长歌》，这个展览呢规模很大，总计有6300多平方米，展品达到2000余件套。纵向上从史前时代一直到当代，横向上呢它包括政治、经济、科技、文化、社会生产、社会生活等等很多方面。比较生动地展示了西藏地方的历史与文化，也是首次将咱们西藏地方史啊与中国国家史进行全面的衔接和贯通的一个展览，是这样的情况。
So, Professor He just introduced the exhibition to us. The exhibition covers areas of more than 6,000 square meters, with 2,000artifacts displayed in the exhibition. It goes over the economy, the development, ecologies of the history of Tibet.
现在我们看到的就是我们西藏博物馆的镇馆之宝，也是我们的馆标设计的一个原型，就是双体陶罐。
So have a look of this pottery jar.It is also the origin of the logo of the Tibet Museum. It is the two-body pottery jar. It is also the most precious treasure in the Tibet Museum.
这件双体陶罐它造型很独特，那个第一个口两个身体，同时呢，它上面有很多纹饰，是几何的折线纹刻画，就是它造型非常独特，然后工艺也很先进。应该说它是代表了咱们西藏新石器文化，甚至说史前文化制陶工艺的一个水平。
So we can see that with its unique shape, it has two body in one pottery, and with this special pattern decorated on the pot, it actually shows the high technique of making pottery in the ancient Tibet.
正是因为它的这个造型很独特，然后造型和工艺啊，整个制作工艺啊很先进，所以在新石器时代，在那个时代生产力比较落后的情况下，咱们制作这样一件作品呢，那应该它的功能或者说用途哈，应该是作为部落的祭祀用的一种礼器，而不是日常使用的生活用具。
So with this advanced skills and technique, it is obvious that the pottery is not for daily use, but for the major events, such as sacrificial rites.
同时啊，它这个造型和它的包括制作工艺啊，与我国北方的这个马家窑文化，也是新石器时代的一个新石器文化，马家窑文化的制陶工艺啊，高度相似。
We can also see from the shapes that it shares the similar characteristics between the pottery discovered in Ma Jiayao and other places in northern China. 谢谢。
那我们走看下一件。
So I doubt that there definitely be a lot more this kind of exhibits, which reflects not merely the elements of Tibet, but all over China. So Professor He will be taking us to another set of exhibits, and let's see what's the story of that one display there.
现在进入的就是早期金属时代，也是西藏史前社会的最后一个阶段。在这一时期啊，咱们在我们西藏地区啊，发现了很多的物件呢，跟很多文物啊，跟咱们丝绸之路有非常丰富的联系。 特别是咱们的三郎烂卡子出土的金银器，还有阿里一带出土的王侯文锦，茶叶，以及这个沙山银币，这些都证明了咱们这一时期咱们西藏地方啊与咱们祖国内地以及中亚和那个南亚一带的一些文化上的交往和交流关系。
So in the ancient China, silk, coins, and coins over there, tea discovered in Ali and other regions in China, which reflects the connections with the ancient Silk Road.
那您可以给我们简单介绍一下我们这个看起来非常复杂的一个展览。
对对，这是2008年啊，就是从阿里地区，就是西藏的西部啊，靠近新疆一带的阿里地区出土的这个王侯文锦，它是有王侯汉字的王侯两个字啊，正方两面都有。那么在这上面是刺绣在上面的一个锦缎啊，制造的一个锦缎。所以这个呢，包括旁边的这个茶叶也是如此。那么这些东西呢，明显的它就是来自于国内的汉晋时期啊，通过丝绸之路，那么传播到西域，传播到中亚一带，就由此呢，那么辐射到了咱们西藏的阿里地区。
So we can see this brocade design with the pattern of bird, animals, and character of king. We can literally see the character of king, which is Wang Hou, on the silk, besides the patterns of birds and animals. It was discovered in 2008 in Ali. Apart from this, the tea and the coins discovered in the western part of Tibet are all the evidence showing connections with the ancient Silk Road.
那么这些文物的出土啊，它也证明了，就是说，第一个它就是延展了咱们这个丝绸之路的网路，同时呢，它也再一次的佐证了咱们丝绸之路，那么通过丝绸之路，内地早期文明向西藏地方辐射这样一个历史事实，证明了，同时也证明了那么高原丝路这个概念的存在。
So with those exhibits, it's actually proved that the Silk Road has prolonged to the region of the high plateau. 所以我们现在是继续往后看。
好的，我们接下来我们去看清代时期啊，这一时期咱们具有西藏的特色的一些民俗用品啊，同时它也反映了与祖国内地的文化的一种交融现象。
So next we are going to get to another series of daily necessaries of Qing Dynasty. Please enjoy a short video on Tibet culture.
The Potala Palace, a landmark in southwest China's Tibet Autonomous Region, features a mural that illustrates a historic marriage between the Han and Tibetan ethnic groups. The mural depicts ancient Tibetan officials standing in a row to welcome Wencheng, a princess of the Tang Dynasty. The princess traveled to Tibet to marry Tibetan King Songtsen Gampo in the 7th century. Similar to the mural,Many other relics in Tibet have helped further uncover cultural communication and integration between the plateau region and the rest of China.
西藏高原呢，我们不能把它作为一个孤立的这个地理单元来去认识，它跟周围的这些区域，在这个旧石器时代开始，一直是有的这个相互的这个人员之间的这个交流，它不是这个封闭的，也不是孤岛。从考古学的这些这个实物证据来讲的话，同样也反映出这样的一些特征。
Murals depicting the marriage between Princess Wencheng and Songtsen Gampo were also found in the Samai Monastery, a famed Tibetan Buddhist temple in Shannon City. Built in the 8th century on the northern bank of the Yalang Zhangbo River, the Samai Monastery was listed as a key cultural heritage site under national level protection in 1996. The temple itself is also a manifestation of cultural integration.
中南嘛，我记得那么大，那等这个，这个，热路大，等这，给他，区别等这也不难呢。嗯，不大家人个天气，到了等，上面这边等这个，
Shaka Wangdu said, since ancient times, Tibet has been a region where cross-cultural concepts and traditions have met and jointly formed the colorful culture of the plateau.
民族它也就是说就像我们一个大海一样，大海它有很多个很多个河流注入到海里，支流支系融入到这个大海，然后就形成了一个最后我们认同的这么一个大的一个族群或者大的一个民族。So now we are here at the last series of exhibits that we're going to introduce today. Let's find out what's special for this set of exhibits.
老师，您可以给我们介绍一下这一套展品有什么特殊之处吗？好的，前面我们看到了很多展品呢，都是从祖国内地传输到西藏，那么，对，把内地的文化，那么带到西藏以后，影响到西藏地方文化，这些现在我们看到的这一组展品呢，它都是具有浓郁的地方特色和民族特色，它都是西藏地方，咱们西藏地方自己。
But this set of series are with strong characteristics of local culture, and it is also made and used in Tibet.
我们看咱们后面的最后一个板块，这里面都是一些历史图片，它就反映了咱们国内各兄弟民族与西藏。 各民族一起，各族人民一起，在西藏地方一起居住、生活、劳作、和睦共处这样一个画面。Now
let's turn back and have a look at these historical photos behind us. They also fully show the prosperity of the integration of different ethnic groups and the common development of the multi-ethnic groups. So really, thanks Professor He for sharing with us his insights today. So.
好，谢谢老师，今天给我们的讲解，辛苦了，辛苦。胖子不客气，谢谢啊，好，再见。So
actually, apart from the relics, Professor He introduced to us today, there are still a lot more stories behind those 2,000 artifacts. To explore the stories, you probably need to have a one-day time, and wish you can have a good conversation with those ancient treasures. So that's all for today's Xinhua Live. I'm Liu Ying. Thank you for watching. See you next time.